He's a senior lecturer in endocrinology at the Tropical Medicine Research Institute and an honorary consultant at the University Hospital of the West Indies. He did his undergraduate medical degree at the University of the West Indies, went on to do his residency in internal medicine at the University of Virginia, and did his research fellowship in endocrinology, diabetes, and metabolism at the Johns Hopkins University School of Medicine. He's board certified in internal medicine, endocrinology, diabetes, and metabolism. His research interests include the roles of adipocytokines, early life events, and hypothalamo-pituitary-adrenal-axis activity in the development of the metabolic syndrome. Let us welcome Dr. Michael Boyne to lead us in this discussion.
Thank you very much, Karen, and I would like to thank the organizers of UDOP for inviting me to speak about alcohol and glucose metabolism, a good mix, or with a question mark. In the original program, I think they had no question mark, as if we should definitely put alcohol and glucose together. But I hope that during this talk, you might see some of the pros and cons about alcohol and glucose. Now, as you probably know, alcohol comes from sugar fermentation or sucrose fermentation. And alcohol has been around for a very long time, from prehistory actually, and evidence as long as 9,000 years ago. And the process, whether it started off with grapes being fermented to give the sugar, to release sucrose, and then afterwards into large fermentation vats, to the more modern way that we now do it, which is a very processed and highly stylized set of biochemical reactions. But alcohol is well known to many of us. Some of us have imbibed alcohol maybe today already. Many of us use it as our favorite mood-altering substance. So we do need to think about it as it relates to diabetes. And one thing that we need to remember about alcohol is that there's no way for the body to really store it. It has to do something with it. And the way to deal with alcohol is to oxidize it. So generally, the active agent of alcohol after the fermentation process is ethanol. And alcohol dehydrogenase will oxidate it to acetaldehyde, which further on is dehydrogenated or oxidized again by acetaldehyde dehydrogenase to acetate. So you might remember some of this from your chemistry days in high school, but just remember that alcohol dehydrogenase and the acetaldehyde dehydrogenase are actually liver enzymes, and therefore they have to be processed by the liver. So if a person consumes alcohol, you'll also notice that you'll be producing lots of coenzymes called NADH, which I can't point to, but you'll see in the red at the top, as well as acetaldehyde and acetate. So since many of us don't like biochemistry, well, there we go, but I do, and Professor Morrison does, I'm just going to give you one or two slides of biochemistry and then we'll get on. And this is really just a summary slide to show you, and I'm afraid I can't walk you through it very well because I don't have a pointer that I can use per se. But if you look over at the right-hand side in the red, with the little red box, that's the process of ethanol being converted over to acetaldehyde and the production of NADH. Now, NADH is going to rise in accumulation, and therefore, the body is going to have to process it. And the way the body will process it is, one, NADH can be utilized to drive that reaction from pyruvic acid to lactic acid, shown in the middle part. So you will get potentially more lactic acid as well as potentially some ketosis. The NADH can also be utilized in lipogenesis, as seen in the upper right-hand corner. So in other words, you can now inhibit lipolysis, the breakdown of lipids, and you're going to stimulate lipogenesis, the synthesis of lipids. And so therefore, you're going to have more triacylglycerols being formed in response to an alcohol ingestion. Alcohol, the NADH can also feed into the electron transport chain and therefore be utilized for the production of ATP energy. But in doing that, it's also going to slow down lipogenesis, as well as, with its interference in the citric acid cycle, cause more ketone body formation. So, and lastly, there is the potential for interference with gluconeogenesis, in other words, a process by which we make glucose, which we do every night when we go to sleep for 8 hours. We have the process of gluconeogenesis making sugar to feed our brains. And the excess of NADH can also have some interference with that, and you can have a greater propensity for hypoglycemia. So more lipids, less sugar, more acid, more ketones. Sort of the take-home message. So bearing that in mind, we'll move forward again if I get this slide to advance. One more time. Oh, there we go. I also wanted to give you the last biochemistry slide, and then we'll move on, is that ethanol also interferes with a key enzyme called AMP kinase. And ethanol can also augment in moderate doses a hormone called adiponectin, which is derived from fat, but in very high dosages of ethanol may inhibit adiponectin. And again, the effect of altering adiponectin levels and AMP kinase can change the amounts of lipid formation and lipid oxidation. Okay, so since we've gotten a little bit of science behind us, what are some of the metabolic effects of alcohol? Well, as we had mentioned before, it can suppress gluconeogenesis and also inhibit what we call the Cori cycle, which is involved with gluconeogenesis. It inhibits fatty acid oxidation. And many reports, and in your textbooks, you'll see it shows very little about having any effect on blood glucose concentration or on the rise of insulin in response to glucose. A matter of fact, most textbooks will say that in non-diabetic subjects, the effects on hypoglycemia are more acute when a person is having glycogen deprivation. In other words, they've been fasting for a period, they've imbibed a lot of alcohol, and then hypoglycemia can occur. When in a person who's otherwise well-nourished and not fasting, that might not be as common. But I'd like you to take us through a few of the the different ways that we might look at ethanol. So one, what are the effects on persons who are at risk of having diabetes? So people who have a family history, maybe they have impaired glucose tolerance, they are obese, etc. That these people who may be at risk of diabetes, is there any data about the effect of alcohol on that risk? And there is lots of data. So first thing is that this is some data coming from Linda Cao from the Johns Hopkins University. And what they were publishing in the American media, sorry, in the American population, is that as people consume more alcohol, men and women, so from the right, the left-hand side, that's consuming less than one drink a day, all the way over to the right-hand side where they're consuming several drinks a day, the proportion changes. So people, when they're not much of a drinker, tend to take more wine. And then when they're more of a drinker, they tend more hard spirits. And even though I don't necessarily have a lot of data for Jamaica, I don't think that's necessarily so. And when I speak about alcohol now, I'm going to speak about spirits, beer, and wine. So there are several observational epidemiological studies that have shown that persons with some alcohol intake seem to have a lower risk of diabetes. And in this slide, as you can see, there is a sort of J-shaped relationship. So the persons who have the lowest risk of developing diabetes were the ones in light to moderate use of alcohol. And the persons who were heavy drinkers or persons who did not drink at all had an increased risk compared to ones who took some alcohol. And I already see some people smiling when they see this sort of data. Now, this has been replicated many times. So this slide is showing another study. The first one was in a set of 5,000 British individuals. This study is in now some Japanese individuals. And there are many other studies which I've listed on the side that show that perhaps moderate use of alcohol may have some protective effect on the development of incident diabetes. Now, the mechanism is not quite well worked out. And it might be, as in some studies, that hormone adiponectin might be a key player in this. But the fact of the matter is, we're not quite certain why. However, there is this sort of J-shaped or U-shaped curve when it comes to alcohol. And there was, in the diabetes care about 5 years ago, a meta-analysis putting all the different studies together, and they again showed a similar relationship that for men and women utilizing non-consumers, people who are teetotalers, don't drink any alcohol at all, that there seems to be some protective effect from alcohol. So the meta-analysis seems to suggest what the observational studies individually were saying. Now, they have also shown in others, or in those same studies, that alcohol does have an effect on other things. So moderate use of alcohol seems to increase HDL concentrations, shown on the left-hand side. And on the right-hand side, it seems to decrease insulin output. As in other words, trying to say that maybe insulin resistance might be improving with some use of alcohol. And in this other study, where they measured insulin resistance utilizing a HOMA technique, and HOMA is basically they're using a fasting glucose and a fasting insulin to make a derivation or to rank people of how resistant they are, they again showed that people with moderate use of insulin seem to have less insulin resistance, and therefore, in comparison to people who never use or people who are heavy users. And I'm going to come to the definition of moderate and heavy in a little while. I know you're waiting for that one. More recently, as in last month, in a set of 19,000 non-obese American women who were observed and in the Boston area, most of them who were utilizing, not most of them, many of them who utilized alcohol did show that persons who took alcohol had a lower risk of overweight or obesity, right? So compared to people who drank nothing at all, that zero column on the left, they had a higher rate of obesity or overweight compared to people on the right-hand side who were actually drinking about 2 to 3 drinks per day. So I think people like that already. But for the men in the audience, I have to tell you, it wasn't true for the men. So what does this data mean? We're not 100% certain, but it seems to be from the dietary recall data that the women who are using alcohol use alcohol in substitute of some calories. In other words, they cut down some of their normal caloric intake and substitute it with alcohol. The men, however, may have been adding alcohol to their usual caloric intake. So the men themselves tended to have more risk of obesity. So there's a sex difference when it comes to use of alcohol. And we do know that men and women are different. Isn't that true? All right. Now, many people like to speak about alcohol is helpful in the prevention of coronary artery disease. And there are several studies that seem to suggest that. But why might that be so? Well, this study published last year in Circulation suggests that moderate use of alcohol, in other words, anywhere from 1 to no more than 3 drinks a day, were explainable by a series of risk factors. In other words, there was a slight lowering in systolic blood pressure, inflammatory markers decreased, there might have been a slight protective effect on glycemia, blood glucose. There was a change in lipids and specifically HDL cholesterol. And putting all of them together, it seemed to explain, as the bottom bar shows, maybe up to about an 86% reduction in the disease. So 86% of the reduction in the disease associated with modest use of alcohol may have been explained by some changes in blood pressure, inflammation, sugar levels, and lipids. People always ask, does the type of beverage matter? You know, should it be red wine, which has a lot of resveratrol, or should it be, you know, beer, etc.? And the data doesn't suggest that one is superior to the other, that they all have the same impact. So what we may also take home is that it's different from person to person, because in this study showed 2 years ago in diabetes that some of the protective effect depends on your genotype. In other words, if you have a particular genotype of the alcohol dehydrogenase enzyme, which helps to deactivate the alcohol as you or oxidize the alcohol as we showed you, you may have a different response to alcohol than a person who does not have that particular polymorphism. So this effect, even though we speak about a population effect, may be quite different individual to individual. Now, for people who do have diabetes, because we were speaking before on persons who don't have diabetes, for people who do have diabetes, what does the other data show? Well, there's always a risk of some impairment in recovery from hypoglycemia induced by sulfonylureas or insulin. So as we mentioned, more heavy use of alcohol can cause a risk of hypoglycemia, especially in people who have impaired glucagon secretion, like many of our persons with type 1 diabetes. And in some European and American studies, alcohol is incriminating in up to 20% of hypoglycemic episodes. It can also cause more severe neuroglycopenia, in other words, the CNS or neurological manifestations of hypoglycemia. It can potentiate effects of sulfonylureas and can be confused. Hypoglycemia and alcohol, their signs and symptoms look very similar and can be confused. So there can be some acute effects in persons with diabetes. The Kaiser Permanente group published this data 2 years ago in over 38,000 people who they observed. Now, this is not a randomized trial. This is an observational trial. And they wanted to suggest that perhaps some alcohol use in moderation, again, may help with lowering of blood glucose in individuals who are known to be diabetic. It's not a lot. If you look, the top right hand, sorry, left hand, in abstainers, the mean A1C is somewhere around 8.7, 8.8. And then a nadir in the persons who are taking about two drinks a day was about 8.2, 8.3. But still a difference. Observational data, and it might be so. And we'll just go ahead. So because of this, a lot of people have a very positive view of alcohol. Very, very positive view. But we have to temper, because you know there has to be moderation in all things. And persons who have high use or consumption of ethanol over time may have significant caloric intake and therefore weight gain. Triglycerides can increase. It can now, in more modest use, can cause increased blood sugars, increased blood pressure, and worsen microvascular disease such as nerve and eyes. And just as a reminder about the caloric intake, the glass of wine that you had last night, assuming you had about 4 ounces, is about 85 calories. The beer that you're going to have afterwards at lunchtime is 150 calories. And the shot that you're going to have after listening to Professor Mabania tonight might be 128 calories. So alcohol does have significant calories that can be added to your diet. So too much over too long can worsen obesity in individuals. And I was going to maybe stop here before, last week to say that the American Diabetes Association, International Diabetes Federation, the Minister of Health of Jamaica, the Caribbean Health Research Council of within our region, generally have these guidelines. Men, you know, if you have diabetes, you can take moderation is key. That's the first thing. And 1 to 2 drinks is okay. And one drink is defined as 15 grams of alcohol. Women should be 1 or less. Taking more than a recommendation can cause hyperglycemia. And so they advocated that if you take alcohol, it should be consumed with food at the same time. And if you have microvascular disease or high triglycerides or uncontrolled blood pressure, you might want to avoid alcohol. And I would have stopped there. But last week things changed. So just as I was about to say, I'm going to finish here, there was this series of data that came out in the British Medical Journal. And I want to just walk you through some of these data. So in the British Medical Journal, they looked in observational studies in men and women at a risk of cirrhosis and liver failure, something that we don't normally talk about in persons with diabetes. We talk about, you know, renal impairment, we speak about heart disease, etc. And cirrhosis is as an end stage, and as you know, can only be treated effectively by transplant. The relative risk of cirrhosis in 1.2 million British women in this observational study varied according to BMI. In other words, the higher their BMI over the normal range, the more the risk of cirrhosis. So there seems to be what could be the cause of BMI interacting with the development of cirrhosis. And And when they looked at those same 1.2 million women and looked at their alcohol consumption, you can see their risk is modified by the amount of alcohol that they consume. In other words, if you are relatively lean and consume a bit of alcohol, is not as you're better off than if you're consuming the same amount of alcohol but you're now obese. So there might have been an additive or synergistic effect of alcohol and BMI with liver pathology. And they estimated that there was a relative risk of 28%, relative risk increase of 28% for every 5-unit increase in BMI over 22 for whatever level of alcohol that you consumed. So this study was provocative, and it raised the gambit to say, is this an additive or a synergistic effect? And the second study that was also in the same issue showed now in Scottish men, nearly 10,000 Scottish men, if you look at their baseline levels, so they're now looking again, BMI and alcohol as it relates to its risk of cirrhosis or liver disease, the baseline risk is increased by 29% once your BMI goes up. If you add alcohol, your risk goes up 3.6-fold. And if you have the two of them together, in other words, increase of weight as well as alcohol, you now have a 9.5 increased risk, fold increased risk of developing liver disease. So this prompted an editorial speaking about both of them, and there is an interaction between alcohol and liver. Now, why is that of any significance to us? Because of, and I'm sure our next speaker may even mention or allude to this, the aspect of what we call non-alcoholic fatty liver disease. Now, it is estimated that 3 in 10 American adults have non-alcoholic fatty liver disease, or NAFL, right? And you can see by the right-hand corner that there's a normal liver, and then there's a fatty liver above it. And it's more common in persons with obesity and diabetes. So as you can see that in fatty liver, fat accumulates, and then you can move on to non-alcoholic steatohepatitis, where you get inflammation and scarring. And if this is unabated, one can now develop cirrhosis, hepatic failure, need for transplant, etc., or hepatoma. So gradually, over the process of time, a fatty liver in some individuals, not everyone, in some individuals can progress to a more advanced stage of hepatitis. And I'm sure many of us have had a patient or two that you sent them to do some investigation, maybe they had an ultrasound, and it also shows, hey, they have a fatty liver. So the process of fatty liver is actually due to lipotoxicity. In other words, increased levels of fatty acids, which is common in insulin-resistant individuals, will increase reactive oxygen species by its interaction through the electron transport chain, peroxisomes, etc. And these can increase the amount of cytokines and chemokines and therefore lead to a process of inflammation. So our risk factors for NAFL: obesity, cholesterol, hypertension, type 2 diabetes, up to 70% of people may have fatty liver, and anyone with insulin resistance or people who like to drink a lot of sodas, right? Just shown just recently. The only way to diagnose it definitively is by a liver biopsy. But we can't liver biopsy everybody. But if you have a person with obesity and type 2 diabetes with abnormal liver function tests, you would want to investigate them or think about whether or not this could be due to a fatty liver, NAFL, or not. Now, the jury is still out on what is the best way to do this. Is it, should it be by, you know, transaminases, ALT? It doesn't seem to be ALT is a very sensitive marker. Should it be by ultrasound? That itself may not be so good. Could it be by CT scan? More expensive and risk of radiation. So there's still the jury's out on exactly what's the best way to diagnose it. But if you do have NAFL, you may be at more risk of having disease. However, there are different treatments. So in this diabetes article, you may see that rosiglitazone, as well as, I'm also going to show you a slide for pioglitazone, decreases significantly the amount of fat that is in a fatty liver. Here's the same data for pioglitazone. It decreases inflammation, necrosis, and fibrosis significantly, between 30 and 60%, depending on the studies that you read. So one of the things that we may want to think about is that as a person with obesity and type 2 diabetes, they may move from a situation of having a normal little liver to a fatty liver to fibrosis, and there are ways we can intervene. Diet and exercise, first and foremost, in preventing the slide. However, other areas such as metformin and other insulin sensitizers can be useful in the delay of the progression downwards towards non-alcoholic fatty liver. And so we may still utilize the same guidelines, but especially in some of these new data, I suspect that one other restriction for alcohol might be if there's any evidence of fatty liver in our individuals. So consider that for the type 2 patient, you may want to avoid alcohol or advise them to avoid alcohol if there's any evidence of fatty liver disease. And with that, I thank you for your time and patience.
Thank you very much, Dr. Boyne, for that very informative presentation. I think we are out of time for questions for this one, but we'll see if we have time at the end to accommodate questions. I'll go into the second presentation, which is being given by Dr. Samuel Dagogo Jack, who is very highly acclaimed. Dr. Jack is the A.C. Mullins Professor in Translational Research, Professor of Medicine and Chief of the Division of Endocrinology, Diabetes and Metabolism at the University of Tennessee Health Center. He is the Director of Endocrinology Fellowship Program and of the Clinical Research Unit of the Clinical and Translational Research Institute at the same institution. He completed postdoctoral fellowship training in endocrinology at Washington University School of Medicine and served on the faculty at Washington University for 8 years. He's board certified in internal medicine, diabetes, and metabolism. He has numerous research interests, but I'll mention the pathobiology of prediabetes and diabetes and the regulation of leptin in humans. He's very widely published. He has about 16 book chapters and more than 200 scientific papers and abstracts. He is He has served in various capacities in major societies and is a recipient of the 2008 Distinction in Clinical Endocrinology Award from the American College of Endocrinology and the 2009 Meritorious Achievement Award from the National Medical Association. He's eminently qualified to speak to us today on the glycemic intervention, interaction with cardiovascular complications. Thank you.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. And I thank the Right Honorable Professor Earl Morrison, represented here by his First Lady, for once again inviting me here. I've been coming since UW Zero in 1993, because I assume that if this is 16th UW, and I was here speaking on UW in 1993, 2010 minus 1993 would be 17 years. So that 93 was not counted. So where's Professor? He's not here. We'll have to do the math again. Secondly, I decided to escape from the podium because I don't want the chairman to stand behind me to ask me to shut up. You also will notice that when she stood behind Dr. Boyne, he did not shut up, so I have a precedent. And when she was introducing me with those kind words, I was blushing because I was feeling embarrassed saying so many things in my presence. So I went and stood behind her, and she did not stop. So based on all of these precedents, I will use my full 30 minutes. Okay? Now, the program says latest advances in thiazolidinediones and diabetes, and what could be later than the cardiovascular issue. So that is where I am going to focus. The fact that we are in the midst of a full and raging diabetes epidemic throughout the world is no longer disputed. But what is even more troublesome is that the projected increases in the rates of diabetes are phenomenally tilted to the disadvantage of the developing countries. And this slide, which I borrowed courtesy of Dr. Larry Wilkins from St. Lucia, actually projects that by the year 2030, the proportionate increase in the numbers of diagnosed diabetes in Jamaica would be more than twofold. And you can all appreciate that no one island in the Caribbean is spared that trajectory and the increased rates of diabetes, and that underscores the rationale for primary prevention, which could be the subject of another meeting. We make a lot of noise about diabetes because of the distant but definite complications that it can cause. Many times in the clinic, we as clinicians actually feel the fear for our patients because they are often disengaged and not cognizant of this retinopathy that we're concerned about, the neuropathy, the nephropathy, the cardiovascular. They are such a distant, remote risk in their minds, and their concern is a day-to-day blood sugar control, and they sometimes think we go overboard demanding them to eat right, check their blood sugars, take this pill, that shot, etc. And I think we are well-founded when we continue to worry for our patients because they lack the clinical training that has expanded our vision into looking into the distant one or two decades of future life and what it holds for our patients. Now, the pictures you see on the screen are ugly pictures of the eyes, damaged by diabetes, actually bled into portions at 5 o'clock and 9 o'clock there. The ordinarily beautiful glomerular tuft and Bowman's capsule and so on has been distorted here on the right by the so-called Kimmel-Still-Wilson deposit, the hyaline-like distortion in the glomerulus, clumping of the cells, mesangial expansion, that white halo you see. And what you don't see is an increase in transglomerular pressure that forces a kind of dialysis of protein into the collecting tubules, which we pick up as microalbuminuria, the earliest stage of incipient diabetic nephropathy, for which there is really no cure when it's end stage, other than dialysis, which is palliative, or renal transplantation. 50% of people in the United States who end up in the dialysis center got there because of diabetes. So this is serious. Now the other picture you see there, it's not an obscene gesture, the picture on the bottom. It's not a hand, it's actually the lower extremity missing a number of digits. Some less than pure-minded people in the audience might be thinking it was somebody giving the hand, but it's the foot. And again, below the knee, amputations are very rife and prevalent among patients with diabetes. In fact, as I speak, if you see anybody on the streets of America working on crutches or losing a limb, and you guessed that if they didn't lose that limb by involvement in motor vehicle accident or in a warlike trauma, they have diabetes. If you made that guess and you were a betting person, you'll be correct 50% of the time. That's how terrible this disease has become. So the microvascular complications, these three leading poster children for microvascular small vessel complications, are known to be very sensitive to glucose control, and I will show you some data. But the other picture that just showed up, popped on the screen, is that was taken from a post-mortem sample of a gentleman who died from fatal myocardial infarction. And you can see the calcified plaque there in the southern pole of the picture. You can see distortions, atherosclerotic lesions. This is end stage from Frust. End stage atherosclerotic lesion that ended up taking the life of the patient. Does that lesion, the so-called macrovascular or large vessel complication of diabetes, also respond to glucose control? That has been the contentious and most important question of our time. First, microvascular. This picture was taken from the NHANES study, but similar pictures have been developed with studies in Egypt and among Pima Indians, showing that the relationship between blood glucose when measured by hemoglobin A1C or fasting glucose or 2-hour oral glucose tolerance value and the incidence of retinopathy is nonlinear until a threshold level, typically around a fasting glucose of 126, A1C of 6.5, when it skyrockets. So this is primary proof of the relationship between glucose levels and the microvascular complications of diabetes, and it sets up a glucocentric hypothesis, which has since been solved. So the corollary of the hypothesis is that if there is such an exponential relationship between glucose and retinopathy, if you bring the glucose down, will the retinopathy go away? Or can you prevent the risk? And again, I'll show you classic data that speak to that. This slide I'll skip because you've already heard quite a brain full of biochemistry, but these are the mechanisms linking glucose to tissue damage. And I will mercifully skip the slide if it would go away. Oh, it has. So now you look at the landmark studies that solved the glucose hypothesis for us. And to the top right of me, which is to your left, is the DCCT study, the famous DCCT study, where two groups of type 1 diabetic patients were treated to two levels of glucose control. The better treated group, the lower curve shown in red color, had their A1C brought down to 7% within 6 months of joining the study and kept there for the next nearly 9 years that followed. The top level are the control group, and they had their A1C stuck at 9%, and they lived at 9% for a decade. At the end of this study, the better treated group had nearly 70% reduction in the risk of developing retinopathy and similar degrees of protections from neuropathy and nephropathy. The slide to the right of that is a similar study conducted among type 2 diabetic patients in Japan, sometimes known as the Kumamoto study or the Hokuba trial, using identical design that was used in the diabetes control and complications trial. reaching similar dichotomies of glucose control, 7% group versus 9% group, and generating nearly identical degrees of results in terms of protections. The bottom slide is the UK PDS study, the United Kingdom Prospective Diabetes Study, and that study used two types of treatments, intensive glucose control versus conventional policy. The intensive group reached and maintained a median hemoglobin A1C of 7%, but unlike the other two studies where the control group was stuck at 9%, in this latter study, the control group had a median hemoglobin A1C of 7.9%. So there was only a 0.9% spread between the two groups. And you could see that over time, there was a northward drift in the hemoglobin A1C, not the flattening that you see in the other other studies. Despite that drift, at any time point of measurement, the hemoglobin A1C folks, 7% folks, experienced about 25% reduction in risk. So we believe that both in type 1 and type 2 diabetic patients, we have accomplished evidence that glucose control can reproducibly reduce the risks for development of retinopathy, nephropathy, and neuropathy. So the question is, what about the large vessel diseases? The cardiovascular disease, the strokes, and the peripheral vascular disease. After all, those are the reasons that most of our diabetic patients die. Ever since the discovery and widespread use of insulin, diabetes has retreated as the cause of death. In other words, hyperglycemia, diabetic ketoacidosis, crisis-grade high blood sugar is immediately treatable with parenteral insulin. It is the chronic complications, particularly atherosclerotic diseases, that now kill nearly 80% of our patients with diabetes. Several studies, too numerous to cite here, have been conducted to test the relationship between glucose and cardiovascular disease. Many of those are population studies and case series, and they fall short of maintaining a commanding hold on the evidence. The evidentiary dichotomy in our line of work is such that if you have a boatload of meta-analysis and epidemiologic studies and association studies, and you have just one well-conducted randomized clinical trial, that one good study will tip the scale in favor of science on its side, and all of those other hypothesis-generating meta-analysis studies will have to be abandoned, whatever they should. In most cases, a randomized control study will trump these other studies. And if you were to stack on a hierarchy of solidity of evidence of value, scientific value, the various types of research that I and my colleagues dream up and conduct, the meta-analysis and case reports would be in the pit, in the basement, and the RCT, the randomized control trial, would be at the pinnacle. Such is the relationship. And so we are and should be looking for randomized control studies published in good journals. So this is one such study that looked at the relationship between glucose and cardiovascular events in patients with type 1 diabetes. It's an extended follow-up of the DCCT cohort, and the original 1,441 patients assigned to two treatments, A1C 7% versus 9%, were followed long-term. And as you can see, the endpoints, primary endpoints, were CVD, cardiovascular disease events, and the pre-specified number of greater than 90 events was crossed in 2005 after having followed this group since back in 1998 when they joined this study. The primary endpoints were defined as fatal and non-fatal myocardial infarction, stroke, and cardiovascular deaths, and it was a time-to-event analysis. What we see next are the actual results, and the lower lines in the green coloring indicate the reduced incidence of time to cardiovascular events, cumulative events, in those whose hemoglobin A1C had been at 7%, and the higher curves were the 9%ers, clearly indicating nearly 50% reduction in the aggregate risk of fatal or non-fatal cardiovascular events and cumulative incidence of strokes and other events. So 42 and 57%, depending on the analysis. This is the first and perhaps only randomized controlled evidence of showing direct reduction in the risk of cardiovascular disease by treating blood sugar, analyzing just blood sugar. When we did the secondary multivariable analysis and factored in all of the other known predictors like use of ACE inhibitor, aspirin, blood pressure control, etc., glucose control, A1C, during the course of the DCCT explained 97% of the variance in primary outcomes. So this is as solid as it gets. The problem is only about 5% of persons with diabetes have type 1 diabetes worldwide. 95% have type 2 diabetes. So do we or can we generate similar studies showing the importance of glucose reduction as a means to reducing cardiovascular risk in the more prevalent form of diabetes? And that is where the problem looms large. What you see on this slide are three studies together guzzling up more than $200 million, largely of taxpayers' money in the United States, that tested exactly the hypothesis that I showed you in the previous study in type 1 patients, but this time the testing was conducted in patients with type 2 diabetes. And I know we might run out of time, so I just give you the bottom line. All three studies reported negatively with regard to whether aggressive control of blood glucose to levels consistent with hemoglobin A1C of 7% or lower, in some of the studies 6.5%, and in one of them less than 6%, sustained over years, will reduce the risk of heart attacks and other cardiovascular events, and it did not. The first of the studies to report fully is the VADT, the Veteran Affairs Diabetes Trial. You see those two familiar lines, control group on top, worse A1C, intensive group, lower line, better A1Cs, followed for many, many years, 5 to 7 years on average. Notice that the participants were aged in their 60s, and they've had diabetes for about 11 years, time since diagnosis. Notice also that about a third or more of them, in the lower box there, have had previous cardiovascular events. These are themes that will come back to haunt us when we try to interpret the negative studies, because unlike the type 1 diabetes study conducted in younger persons with no prior cardiovascular events, in fact, people with a history of what may sound like cardiovascular events were removed, were not enrolled. It was an exclusionary criterion. So this is what we are seeing now. We enrolled more than a third who've had a heart attack or stroke, and then we treat them aggressively to control blood glucose to disparate levels, one group getting very excellent control, the reference group staying around 8%. We follow for 5 to 7 years, as in the VADT, and we find nothing. What you see there on the screen are the Kaplan-Meier curves, the so-called survival curves, and they are snaking over each other. The space between them is not significant, and intensive treatment is actually on top, and standard therapy is below. No matter how you look at the data, you cannot make the case that the effort, time, and expense that went into driving the hemoglobin A1C down to 6.5% or thereabouts yielded any dividends with regard to protections from cardiovascular disease. The advanced study was the European-Australian study, that followed the same now classical paradigm, get thousands of people into your study, flip the coin and randomly assign them to two types of glucose control: intensive control yielding a lower A1C level maintained over time, less intensive control, which is a standard care, and then count cardiovascular events over time. This study achieved hemoglobin A1C target of 6.5% in the intensive group versus 7.5% in the control group. And after adjudicating all of the events and analyzing the data, it generated, again, no evidence that glycemic control reduced macrovascular events. You can see the slide to the right half. Now, the investigators practiced a little sleight of hand, so in one of the outcome measures was to combine microvascular and macrovascular endpoints as a composite. Now, we're not arguing that microvascular, like retinopathy and neuropathy, those complications do respond exquisitely to glucose control. So when the two were bundled, here you can see some space between the lines in the slide to the left there. And that slide actually showed a 10% advantage to risk reduction. But when we separate large and small vessel diseases and plot them separately, the macrovascular complications did not respond to glucose control. So that's 2 out of 3 studies. The third study is even more worrisome. This is the ACCORD trial supported by the National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute. And the lower curve is A1C of between 6 and 6.5, and the upper curve, 7.5. The study was planned as a 5 to 7 year study. Sometime into the study, it was observed that more people actually were dying from the intensive glucose control arm. They were experiencing 3 excess deaths for every 1,000 person years of follow-up. And the study was prematurely stopped. The glucose arm was prematurely stopped because, unlike the hypothesis, it was actually proven the opposite. So based on these negative studies, we are no longer permitted to promise our diabetic patients that glucose control is going to save them from suffering heart attacks. We cannot honestly do that. We definitely can continue to promise protection from blindness, which is not a mean accomplishment, protection from kidney damage, amputations, from controlling the glucose. But we're not quite sure anymore whether glucose control per se is going to cut it. Now, the other question that is important to discuss up front here is whether any of the medications we're using to treat diabetes may be contributing to the cardiovascular problem. That's far from what we intended. After all, the Hippocratic Oath says, primum non nocere, first do no harm. So we are not in the business of inadvertently harming our patients. So it is center stage now. Unless you've been hiding under a rock, you cannot fail to have noticed some argument every week, editorial, somebody's opinion about this drug and that drug. So I want to really devote the remaining couple of slides to it. The Food and Drugs Administration in the U.S. has mandated that drug manufacturers put out this in their labels, the diabetes drugs, that to date, no anti-diabetic medication has been demonstrated to significantly reduce cardiovascular risk. And that is true. But the question is, do they increase? Is there any anti-diabetic drug that increases cardiovascular risk? If that is so, and there be such a drug, we should flee from the drug. In fact, it shouldn't be on the market if it is credibly shown to have increased risk. Very few studies, you will be shocked, have actually been conducted and completed to address this issue. It's only recently that the Food and Drug Administration is requiring new submissions for drug approval in the diabetes space to also initiate a non-toxicity study. So what I'm going to show you are the only studies in the firmament that we can draw from. The first is the RECORD trial, rosiglitazone evaluated for cardiac outcomes and glycemic and regulation of glycemia in diabetes. Before these studies, results were reported, we had inferred from the ACCORD trial that used rosiglitazone in 90% of the intensively treated patients that there was no drug relationship. The people who took the drug were not more likely to suffer a heart attack or less likely, so there was no fingerprint of a drug effect. But that was a secondary distillate from the primary data. The Veteran Affairs study, VA study, also looked at their rosiglitazone treated group, and they did not express any disproportionate or different pattern of cardiovascular risks. But that too was not an a priori research question. It was post hoc analysis. So now we have studies that initially posited to test a primary endpoint of dying from diabetes or being hospitalized with a heart attack or having any cardiovascular related deaths during the study, and half of the 4,400 patients were treated with rosiglitazone Avandia, the other half took metformin or glyburide. So these are active comparators. You have to come down to get me out. I have 5 minutes, please?
1 minute.
Okay, so the studies then showed that if you compared on the green line, rosiglitazone-treated folks, and on the white line, other active diabetes drugs, metformin or sulfonylurea, you do not see a hair's breadth space between the lines. What you see is 2 to 3% event rate annually throughout the 7 years of study, leading to the reassuring conclusions that exposure to neither rosiglitazone nor the other drugs in and of itself revved up the rate of cardiovascular events. Diabetes leads to heart attacks, and regardless of what medication is on board, the rates were similar. Further analysis corroborated that primary conclusion. The other study, also funded, this one funded by NIH, is the BARI-2D study, conducted mostly by cardiologists, and they used rosiglitazone in 89% of the TZD-treated arm in a paradigm that compared insulin sensitizers with insulin secretagogues. So because we have such a large use of rosiglitazone, we can look at what is happening. So if you compare insulin sensitizer IS arm to insulin provision arm, you see those lines, you can barely notice that there are two lines. You see a top line and then the bluish dotted line. Those are supposed to be rosiglitazone versus non-rosiglitazone like sulfonylureas, and there is no difference in the cardiovascular event rates or in the death rate overall. Then most recently, the journal Circulation looked at the study I just showed you, the BARI-2D study, in greater depth. And what they looked was the heart attack rate, because this has come up repeatedly. Do some diabetes drugs raise the risk of myocardial infarction? When they looked at specific myocardial infarction analysis, they found that in the insulin sensitization arm, the relative risk decreased 0.32. That's like 68% protection. And now that reached statistical significance. And the 95% confidence intervals of the hazard ratio did not straddle unity. So you can see now that in a focused sub-analysis, we are seeing the opposite. Rather than saying insulin sensitization therapy, predominantly with rosiglitazone, would have pushed event rates higher, we're actually seeing a reduction in the risk of myocardial infarction. And to date, more than 20,000 patients have been enrolled in studies that compared rosiglitazone to other active diabetes drugs, followed for years, sometimes 3 years to up to 7 years. All of these studies have reported their findings. They are all randomized control studies. And not one of these studies has given any signal of disproportionate cardiovascular event rates on rosiglitazone. The only caveat we learned from all of these studies is that the risk of congestive heart failure is increased by exposure of patients to TZD drugs like rosiglitazone because of fluid retention. And people with congestive heart failure are not suitable candidates for exposure to these agents. If we observe that caveat and use healthy subjects and treat them with these agents, we will get the glucoregulatory benefits, we'll get the other anti-inflammatory benefits, and we should not see any step up. disproportionate increase in cardiovascular risk. Thank you very much for your patience. And thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Dr. Jack, for that very insightful presentation. I think we'll allow just two questions.
Yeah, this question is for Michael Boyne. Anecdotally, the use of alcohol in men is associated with increase in abdominal girth and probably increased waist hip ratio. The question is whether that is due to fat or something else. Also, alcohol is associated with a with an increase in HDL, and that particular phenotype that I just described is associated with a low HDL. Do you care to comment on that as to what the possible causes?
When I was a medical student, they would teach that excessive alcohol can induce hypogonadism, and therefore testosterone levels wax and wane, and you can have an increase in intra-abdominal adiposity in response to that. So that, of course, is true in the person who is at the extreme of alcohol use. But I think also that, as was mentioned before, that alcohol is not caloric poor, that there are calories within alcohol, and therefore if you're taking it in excess of your usual caloric requirements, you will have some, or the potential for weight gain. And again, in men, we like to put it on in the intra-abdominal compartment more than the women. I'm sorry, I didn't get the second question. Was about HDL, whether or not HDL is, raise HDL?
I was just making a comment that particular phenotype,
yes,
is usually associated with a low HDL, and given that alcohol is known to raise HDL.
Raise HDL, right. Yeah, and that's true. It is a complex interaction, and there is some aspect of the dose of alcohol that one is taking. So again, moderate may have a slight different effect than when you see for the more severe. You probably need to help us do some of the research, Michael.
Okay, one final question.
Thank you. And thanks both speakers for an illuminating presentation. Samuel, my question is to you. You said concentration on blood glucose. I was expecting you to comment on the control of blood pressure.
Absolutely, and if the chairman had not hustled me on the floor, I was going to show the Steno 2 study. So I didn't want to finish on such a disappointing note that no matter what you did with the blood glucose, you couldn't get the heart attack rate down. Well, it's reassuring that you don't raise the heart attack rate by controlling blood glucose. We want to stop at around A1C, about less than 7%. We do not want to go to extremely low levels because that could be risky, especially for older subjects with prior events. But the positive message is that when you control more than the glucose and you add on blood pressure control and lipid control, you get more than 50% in some studies of risk reduction, which now would match what we saw in the DCCT long-term follow-up in type 1 patients. So that's a significant drop. So when we approach our type 2 diabetes patients, we will recognize that is a workspace that calls for multiple risk factor reduction effort. We should not be too overly glucose focused and forget about blood pressure. And when we control the blood pressure, there is evidence that the agent used might even be important. The angiotensin reducing blocking agents might cross protect the kidneys whilst also having additional benefits on cardioprotection. Yes, Dr. Mbaya, thanks for giving me an opportunity to extend my remarks in that regard.
Okay, thank you very much. And let us thank our presenters once again for two excellent presentations. Thank you.